I want to begin with the English title, Ash is Purest White, and how you arrived at that.
写这个剧本的时候，就是我一开始就确定中文的片名叫《江湖儿女》。《江湖儿女》这个名字是在五十年代的，就是四十年代末五十年代初费穆导演，就小城之春的导演，他准备筹拍的最后一部影片，后来他过世了，没有拍，然后就被别的导演拍出来。那个电影，我们一直不知道它的存在，然后到我在，有一年去采访小城之春的女主角韦韦女士的时候，韦韦女士讲了这个事情，然后我当时就被江湖儿女这个词所吸引，然后它是一个很古老的词组，因为这个所谓江湖啊，在中文里面就是它指那种四海为家的人，也指那种 地下社会的人，那么儿女是有情有义的人，因为江湖的原则就是情义嘛。这样的话，就一直是用江湖儿女这个名字，中文。
The mic for the translator stand is not working.
So actually, when I was writing a script, I already have this Chinese title in mind, which is Jianghu Ernu. I'm going to elaborate on what that means. This particular title is actually a title of a film in preparation for this film by Fei Mu. Fei Mu is a famous Chinese director in the 40s and 50s, and his famous film was Springtime in Small Town. So he was in preparation for this particular film, and he passed away before he actually had the chance to make this film. And later on, another director actually made this film with this particular title. So I actually learned about this particular title or this particular phrase, Jianghu Ernie, as a film name from Wei Wei, which is actually the leading actress of Fei Mu in the film Springtime in Small Town. So when she mentioned that to me, I was very, very moved, and also I'm very pleasantly surprised by how this particular title really captured my attention. And not only that, but also understand that this is something that very, very little known to the general public. And so I was immediately drawn to this particular title. Jianghu, as I mentioned before in the introduction, this is about people drifting around, roaming in the society, or people from the underworld somehow living on the edge or the margin of the society. And ernu as a term, which means that these are the people who dare to love and then also believe in and have faith in loyalty and that kind of complex interpersonal relationship. So I thought that by combining these terms and also as a phrase in a Chinese lexicon or Chinese phrase, it's very, very well known and can immediately trigger a lot of audience to associate this particular term with people that I want to portray in this particular film. So that's the reason why very early on I already decided to use Jianghu Ernu as the Chinese film title.
但是当我告诉我的同事，我正在写一个剧本叫《江湖儿女》，是关于当代中国从2000年到2018年的故事的时候，我的同事很反对，因为《江湖儿女》是一个很古老的词，他的同事们说，啊，你这个电影人家会以为是古装片，还是不用的好。但是我觉得更加的喜欢这个名字，因为对我来说，这个电影 最终想表达的就是过去的经典的人际关系，情谊支撑的这种传统的人际关系，怎么样随着时间的推移，随着中国巨大的变革，一点一点的消失落幕。
So of course, this is a film to capture what's in the contemporary jianghu or underworld from 2001 to 2018. So when I was discussing with my colleagues about this particular title, they didn't really, they weren't crazy about it, just because they said that this particular film, people have this ancient time classical peer drama attached to this particular phrase. So people might think that this is a wuxia film from the bygone eras, and it's a period drama. So I thought that I still like the title. I think it's very classic, and it's very sort of have a lot of historical reference and association to it. And that's exactly what I want to capture with this particular film, is that the values or that kind of complex interpersonal relationship and that kind of dare to love and still have faith in loyalty, the codes of conduct we held so dear in the past, somehow because of the society, the rapid change in China, they are eroding and they are disappearing. And it is something that I think very aptly captured the essence and the spirit for the film. So I insisted on still using Jianghu Ernie as a Chinese title.
那么我的同事懂英文的同事就跟我说这个没法翻译成英文，因为江湖这个词在英文里在其他语言里没有对应的。那我当时就起了一个临时的名字叫 Money and Love， 对，然后我的同事又说这个太粗野了，我其实挺喜欢这个名字的，那后来就觉得那还是看看有没有什么可能性。但是当我写剧本写到这个火山这一场，这个巧巧说火山会经过高温燃烧，它是最纯净的，我一下被这个对白感动，因为我觉得电影中讲的这些人就是在这种时代巨变中经历过这种磨砺，就好像高温一样，然后最终烟消，这个就是就像中文里面的词炮灰一样，被时代裹挟，然后牺牲掉的人，我觉得对他们是那样的无辜跟洁白，所以我就想用这个来做英文片名，然后同事说这个可以翻成英文，这样就变成了这个英文名字，我到现在都念不溜这个英文名字。
So, because the Chinese title is Jianghu Ernie, and we're thinking about how we're going to translate that into English. So my colleagues who knows English, then they realize that Jianghu as a concept is really hard to find an apt translation in English. And it's hard, even if we force it to do a little translation of it, probably American audience or English speaking audience won't be able to understand the reference or the spirits or the genre associated to it. So I thought that, okay, what about we go by Money and Love as an English title? And they said that, well, it sounds very vulgar, very unsophisticated. It might not work, but I thought that, well, I still like that particular English title, but at the same time, I was open to other possibilities and options. So when we are filming and then trying to get to the part of the volcanic ash part, the scenes in front of the volcano, I suddenly realized that this concept of ash, because of the heat of the volcano, suddenly purify and then produce this purest form of ash, is somehow what I'm trying to capture with this particular film, is that people, especially innocent people, they sacrifice themselves in this particular social and political context with such a dramatic changes around them, almost as if that they, because of the pressure, because of the heat of the society, completely burn them out, and they incinerated into this ash in the air, almost like dust in the air, so insignificant, and no one pay attention to them. And somehow I thought that this is very, very symbolically a great way to not only capture the essence of the film, but also related to the volcano ash that in the scene. So that's the reason why we arrived at this particular English title. And till this day, it it's very difficult for me to actually pronounce the English title correctly and smoothly.
Then I want to ask a follow-up question before we take questions from the audience, which is that when you use the phrase the pressure of society on your characters, that relates to something that I'm curious about, which is how your films have all built from one to the next. It feels to me that you build one film based on your experience of making the last one and then moving on and then through time, and each time dealing more and more clearly and succinctly with this question of how society puts the pressure of society on individuals. I'm wondering if that seems just to you.
你一直拍的这些片子里面，一部接着一部这样子，几乎都在讨论这样子社会的压力或社会这样巨变对人对这些一些普通人老百姓或者是一些个体发生的一个什么样重大的变化，不管是社会上变化或者是人自己本身产生的变化，是不是一直都有一个母题或者主题，就想要去探索，就是透过所有这一直以来拍的片子去探索这样子的一个主题。
对，因为我觉得我最初想拍电影的时候，正好中国这个就是进入到了一个巨变的一个年代，我的成长，然后让我想成为一个导演，然后一直关注的是这样一个巨变里面人的个人的生存的问题，因为这场变革它也是一个。 自上而下的，然后快速的集中了国外可能一两百年的发展，在中国就是在40年里面要完成这样的一个迅速的改变，你比如说从电话我们就能看出来，可能这个到90年代中国人的家庭都基本没有什么电话，然后到90年代末开始家里面装电话，然后同时呢手提电话已经出现在生活里面，就是它是那样急剧的。 那人呢，他仍然受到了社会的每一丝细微的变化的影响，个人生活都会受到影响，就是可能在我的小的时候是计划生育的年代，我作为小学生都上街宣传过计划生育，然后一个家庭因为这个政策，所以只能生一个孩子，然后等2年前突然说鼓励你们生孩子，每家可以生2个了，然后就是连生孩子都会。 被安排、被影响、被打扰，所以我觉得对我来说，只要关注人，就必然会关注到这个个体背后影响生活的社会的压力、人的生存的这种困境，我觉得这种困境属于每个中国人，也属于我自己，我也在这样的环境里面感受生活，因为我讲太多了，你先放手。
So in terms of this dramatic and transformation and drastic changes that we experience in China, it's very much my growing up experience. And I experienced that kind of how for the survival of the individual, how they react to the changes of the society firsthand. And the changes that have been actually made for our society is very much of the top-down directives that somehow foster this dramatic transformation. Things that usually take 100 years for other countries that we or the country itself wanted to make it happen in 40. So if you look at what's happening in the 90s in China, at the time people started to actually install landline phones. But at the same time, that's the same period of time that you started to see the appearance and emergence of mobile phone as well. So you can see how that it's synchronistic with the rest of the world, but at the same time that we are trying to catch up and trying to produce that kind of social change in a very, very short period of time. And these changes might be very minute, but at the same time, it has and they have very significant impacts on individuals' lives. I can give you another example about when I was growing up. I grew up in this government's directive for family planning for one-child policy, but recently that particular policy changed and now they encourage you to actually have a second baby. So I do think that even for things like childbirth, about your rights to actually to procreate, is something that can be easily controlled, manipulated, and also monitored. It's something that have huge and significant impact on how individuals live their lives. And I do think that all these difficulties and how people relate to these type of day-to-day difficulties of an individual against this backdrop of a fastly changing China very much is why I want to make the film I want to make, and focus on those individuals and how they relate and react to that pressure, as you mentioned in your question.
Take some questions from the audience. Yes. Wait for the microphone.
贾导你好，我是一名大三的学生，然后正在纽约大学学习电影。我是一直就非常非常崇拜您的作品，尤其是您作品当中的女性角色，然后时间和空间的关系，包括您每一次对于这个音乐的选择和方言的使用。所以说我就像在刚刚那部电影作品当中，我是又一次的体会到这些细节，并且被感动。所以我的下面的问题可能更多是出于一个科长粉的心态，就是说，像大家所知道的，您是从非常非常年轻就开始指导长篇，获奖，然后这些年持续不断的能够带给观众好的作品，并且您保持了您自己的这种创作风格，去记录一个时代的变迁。那对于很多的，尤其是年轻的电影工作者来说，不论是从创作上，或者说技术上，或者生活体验上，您有哪一些经验或者是故事愿意分享？谢谢。
You want me to do it, right? Okay. So as a film student, studying film here in New York, and I do think that I was very moved by a lot of details, the way that you portray female characters, the way you express different temporal and spatial elements, the way you use music, the way you use dialect. It's very much something that really really attract me and also make me a lifelong fan of yours. And I do hope that the question I'm about to ask you, you will know that it's coming from a perspective as a fan of yours and really want to learn from you. So as you since you have been making films since we were very young and have been making films for so many years and you received so many accolades and awards, and you still maintain that type of integrity in terms of your style, in terms of your beliefs and creativities in your films. So I want to know what kind of encouragement or suggestions that you want to share with the young filmmakers like myself in terms of the creative process, in terms of techniques, in terms of life experience that you think will really help us become a better filmmaker.
Oh. 我慢慢讲。
So I will answer this question very, very thoroughly and slowly.
我就刚才提到了方言啊，就是在这个我的很多电影，包括《江湖儿女》，《江湖儿女》的前半部分都是山西话，后来因为他们从山西去了山这个去了。三峡，又从三峡去了新疆，那语言开始逐渐过渡到普通话，因为他们要跟外地人交流。我一直喜欢用方言写作，是因为我本人是一个山西人，在中国有不同的方言，然后每一种方言实际上就是每一种语言，我想都是一种思维方法跟情感方法。所以在我笔下的人物，很多时候他是我的一种情感方法。我觉得我很难想象我笔下的人他不是用方言思考跟处理问题的。那我最熟悉的是山西话，我就让我的人物老是山西人，一直是山西人。
So in terms of the dialects, I do think that as you can see from Ashes Purest White, The first part of the film actually in Sanxi dialect. It's not until when they move to other parts of the countries, to the Three Gorges and then through Xinjiang, in order for them to actually communicate with people outside of Sanxi, they then change into Mandarin. So I do think that the reason why dialects is very important in my film, many films that I have made, is because I do think that the dialect you speak is part of your core identity. It really dictates the way you think, the way you feel, the way you deal with the interpersonal and other issues in your life. So it's hard for me not to think about the individual on the capture is not somehow speaking in certain dialects, because that particular elements will really somehow shape how this person think, how this person feel, and how this person behave and react to certain situation. And that's the reason why I always go to the dialect that I'm very familiar with, because I am from Shanxi province, and this is the dialect that I speak, and that is part of my core identity.
那第二个呢，就是关于女性角色。 在最近的两部影片，就《Mountains Meet Bird》跟这个《江湖儿女》女性角色开始强起来，是一个不自觉的啊，我也不是哎说我这次拍要拍一个女性角色很强的电影，但是写完剧本之后，我再重新读的时候理解的时候，我觉得可能某种程度上《江湖儿女》是带着一种男性的反思在写这个剧本，因为它是有17年的时间跨度，它带给我。 回到过去的时间，重新旅行一遍的一种机会，也带给我回到我过去拍过的电影的地方，重新拍摄的机会，带有这样一种回顾性质的拍这个写作跟拍摄的时候，不知不觉我自己对男性的弱点开始有了一些反思，因为就好像我们刚才一直在说江湖的精神在。 消失改变过去经典的人际关系在改变，那是什么呢？最主要就是情谊。过去我们人和人相处，是重情重义的。那么随着这个经济的这种快速发展，社会重新被经济组织之后，就是金钱、经济关系变成了重新结构人们关系的一个东西。那传统的那种就是人际关系就开始。 开始落幕，男性在这个过程中比较多的追随这种主流价值、金钱啊、权力啊，那带来了非常多的迷失。但反而在我们的社会里，女性她们有更多的注意力在情感上面。那么也可能正因为这个原因，在《江湖儿女》里面，男人就暴露了很多的缺点，然后就越来越软弱，女人就变得相对来说强大。
It's fine. So in terms of female characters, and I think for my previous film, Mountain Don't Depart, and this film, Ash is Purest White, I actually unconsciously developed the characters that as you saw in this particular film and the one before. It's not because I wanted to purposefully make films about strong female characters. It's later on after I finished the script and looking back, I suddenly realized that there is this thread of almost as if that I'm using not only the time span of 17 years to, and also the perspective of a male character as a male director start to rethink and to reflect and to re-examine a lot of issues and where we are in society as a male person and as a male director and whether or not this is where we want to be and where we want to go towards the future. So it's very much about a film of self-reflection and self-examination. And to me, coming from that particular perspective, I suddenly realized that a lot of people around me, that when I observe, especially male colleagues or male friends or male just populations in China right now, because of the drastic change and development, economically speaking, a lot of them, they tend to lost themselves in the pursuit of wealth and power, and because that's what the mainstream culture dictate them to pursue. Whereas for the female counterparts, they tend to still maintain and insist on or adhere to the a lot of values that we held so dear in the past, including the close interpersonal relationship, in terms of certain codes of conduct that in this case will be in the underworld, that somehow the female characters are the one that actually are still trying to adhere to it and try to sustain it. So unconsciously, I then develop the male characters in this film that getting weaker and weaker as the narrative and as the story progress. And for the female character, on the other hand, it's getting stronger and stronger as the story unfolds. So I think that it is a way for me to somehow offer this opportunity for the male audience to really think about, to challenge themselves, to reflect on what's going on in the past 17 years in this film. And not only for me, it is a journey back temporally, because I have to go back from 2018 to 2001, but also it's a revisit of the places that I have been to spatially, so that's why I revisited a lot of journeys I have taken making films, early films in the past. And to me, it's really a journey of re-examination, reflection, and re-examining who I am as a male director.
Mm-hmm. 年轻电影工作者或者想拍电影的年轻人来说，我觉得就是寻找到真实的自我非常重要。因为有时候我也会接触到一些年轻导演，他们会说啊，我想拍一部这个戈达尔那样的电影，或者我想拍一个这个贝拉台尔那样的电影。但是我觉得对，我们今天当然是生活在一个影像的时代，我们有很多自己心仪的导演，但是你是谁，你的故事是什么，你最想讲出来的话是什么，就我觉得最终要寻找到自我吧。
So if anything that I can offer younger filmmakers is to really think about what is your motivation, what is your true self as a filmmaker. Because I, when I discuss films with other, with a lot of young filmmakers, they tend to think about a lot of masters that they want to emulate, and I want to make a film just like Godard or other filmmakers that is already very, very well established. But for me, it's really about you need to know and define who you are as a filmmaker. What do you want to say and express with your film? And be true to yourself is something that I will definitely encourage the young filmmakers to seriously consider and think about.
那我觉得就是黑泽明的一句话一直在激励我。他黑泽明曾经说过，他说我一生都在寻找电影之美，但是我到现在都没有寻找到。他在说这句话的时候，他已经是一个很老很老的人。那么这样的一个大师，这样的一个拍了一辈子电影工作的人，他为什么会说他一直在寻找电影之美？我觉得这可能是每个电影工作者，特别是导演，都需要去终身去努力的方向。因为认识我们使用的媒介，寻找电影这个媒介更多的可能性，电影语言更多的可能性，为这个艺术带来新的方法，新的语言，我觉得这个自觉性非常重要，因为我们这个世界是人前的。
So in terms of Japanese skills, director Kurosawa mentioned, and I have this particular quote, is that all through my life as a director, I'm trying to somehow find and seek and obtain the beauty in film or the aesthetics in film. And when he said this particular quote, he already was very accomplished and later in life as a director. So I do think that for all of us, our journey as a filmmaker is to continue to somehow seek that beauty in film and that aesthetics that you want to establish as a filmmaker. And I think with film as a medium, for us as filmmakers to think about how we're going to discover and explore different possibilities using the film language to somehow find a way and a different way and different vocabulary even to tell stories that we want to tell. And I think in order for you to do so, the self-awareness is very crucial and it's very important in order for you to actually continue to somehow seek the beauty and also aesthetics in film.
因为我觉得我们的身处的这个世界跟社会演化的非常快就是每一个年代每一个新的时间段都会出现很多新的感受新的问题新的人的对人的发现跟理解这些新的感受它需要同时用新的电影语言才能表现出来所以我觉得这个它跟社会的演进是同步的电影也需要一直在进化一直在演进所以寻找新的电影语言就是直接就是决定你能不能把最新的生活感受最新的生活问题准确地呈现出来往往旧的语言很难解释新的情绪
So as we are situating ourselves in this particular fastly evolving and changing world and society, I do think that because of that evolution and that the fastly changing landscape and society and the world, we have a lot of many new sensibility and a lot of many new problems that we're facing. And in order for us to very, very aptly and correctly and perfectly capture and depict that type of new sensibility and new problems, we need to create and explore new film language in order for us to actually capture that in our films. So I think that is the way that we need to think about how we're going to make sure that our filmic language evolves along with the society and the world that is evolving around us so that we can find the right vocabulary to describe and to depict the new sensibilities and problems that we're dealing with as humanity.
Thanks. 贾导你好，我是在哥大学新闻的研究生。你在上映前有说到因为今天是情人节然后你觉得不适合看这个电影但是我觉得非常非常的合适因为我今天一个人来然后就看到这么感觉非常自由而且能量场很足的女性角色我觉得非常合适那我的问题其实是关于你刚才在回答中提到的被社会裹挟的人你觉得在当今的中国社会下有哪些人是被社会裹挟是被社会问题影响着的呢以及您现在在关注的社会问题有哪些 So I'm a journalism student at Columbia University I also used to be a translator so you're great Jia was saying before the screening that it's not a particular good film to watch on Valentine's Day but I think it's perfect My friend who was just texting me asking how the film was, I was like, this is great. It's about a strong female lead and a bad man. It's perfect Valentine's. And my question is that, as you said in your answer just now, there are a lot of people, the movie essentially is about how individuals' lives are affected by social issues. So I wonder,What are the social issues you're looking to in the contemporary Chinese society, and how do you think these individuals are affected by them? Thanks.
谢谢你喜欢这个女性形象啊。我觉得，我就可以说我们每个人都被时代裹挟，但是对我来说，我觉得可能在这个过程中最困难的还是那些非权力的拥有者。我在中文使用中文的时候不太说什么底层人民啊或者是这个弱势群体啊我不太喜欢这样分但是我觉得可以分为权力的拥有者跟没有权力不拥有权力的人 而那些不拥有权利的人，大多数人啊，就是是在这个裹挟的过程中更加的被动，更加的无能为力，然后更加的就是这个需要电影去表现，因为他们甚至这个就好像电影的结尾为什么是一个监控器里面的女性的形象，是一个模糊的数码影像，因为就是我们很多人最终就像监视器里的影像一样就被删除了，那都是就是一个虚影啊。但我觉得对于电影来说，就是它是让我们的生命不成为随时被删除的一个垃圾影像的，我觉得最好的方法，它可以呈现这些普通人我们在这个过程中生活的细节，我们所经历的情感啊，对，我觉得所有人都被裹挟，但我关心的是那些非权力的拥有者。
So I do think that actually in general, all people in this particular environment, in this particular social and political context, they're negative impact or affected by it. But for me, I really want to focus on the people that I hate to use a lot of terms that we use, minorities, people are underprivileged. For me, it's really about power. I really want to focus on the people who are powerless or disfranchised, because they are the people who have all the powers and they are people who are just powerless. So I really want to somehow use film as a medium to speak for them, to actually somehow make them significant and can be remembered or recorded in such a way that in their actual reality they are very passive, they are very helpless, but I can somehow use film as a way to make them significant and make them to be recorded, documented, and to be remembered. As you can see from this film, the last shot of the film is about this female character being somehow boiled down or to be broken down into just pixels in a monitor in a surveillance video. So I do think that kind of constant surveillance, and that you are just one of the pixels, and that pixels can be easily erased, is a symbol of how the ordinary people tend, the powerless one, the disfranchised one, tend to be so insignificant and can be easily erased as if that they never existed. So I want to somehow use my film as a way to counter against that kind of easy elimination, or it can easily be erased from not only society, but also from history, using film as a way to really capture them, to then be seen, to be heard, and also to be remembered and to be recorded.
We have to end, that's to break it up, but I really want to thank you all for coming, and thank you very much. Thank you. Happy Valentine's Day.